Always falling apart. Now this is very different from colony. Now this is what's called block culture. That was colony culture. Yeah, this is more familiar because this is how almost everybody commercially produces shiitake.
Oh, this is all shiitake?
Not quite all shiitake. There's a few lion's manes on the last row. We just do a small number of lion's manes, but almost all of this is shiitake. The lion's manes only have to colonize for a couple weeks till we can brood them. The shiitakes have to colonize for like 3-4 months. So those are the ones we just did yesterday. You can see, if you look really close, a little bit of fuzz coming out from the grain, the starter culture. So that's just one day growth, which is almost nothing. Mm-hmm. But just start to see a little white dot there around each grain. Yeah, you can see there, we'll get a few volunteers that will start when they're fully mature. The process of maturing basically goes from the brown of just wet sawdust with some rye grain in it to when it's, we call this whited out, when the mycelia has spread throughout the sawdust. Then there's another stage, actually. I don't see any right at that stage now. Here's some that are doing it. This is called popcorning. So as the colony gets stronger and stronger, the surface starts to pucker. It starts to look like popcorn, kind of. And then the final stage is actually browning, where it forms actually a brown sort of artificial skin on the outside of the colony, wherever it receives good light, which is why we used to have all fluorescents. We're switching over to LEDs because it gives them real good light.
Huh.
But anyway, once they're fully browned like this, nice and dark brown, then we're ready to fruit them. And unfortunately, we can't just punch holes in these bags to fruit them. We actually have to strip the bag off because they fruit all over where that artificial skin is, where they form that brown outer layer. That's how they orient themselves to the outside world. Different mushrooms do that differently. You gotta keep in mind, they don't have eyes and they don't have senses like us. So they're basically just fuzzy fungus growing inside a massive fiber of some sort, often just a big dead log. Mm-hmm. So they need to have some way of knowing where the outside of the colony is so they know where to form their fruiting bodies for reproduction. So some of them do it by sensing the fresh air, and some do it by sensing where there's sunlight exposure. Oh. Others actually do it by sensing where there's contamination, bacteria. Mm-hmm. And those are like a lot of the ground growing mushrooms, so they can sense where the edge of the colony is based on where the contaminants are, and then they grow up through that. That's like ones that they put casing layer on, like button mushroom and wine cap stropharia. So it's different for different mushrooms. But this is a good sample because we have one that's an air sensor and this one's a light sensor. So once they're brown, they're ready to fruit. I didn't really give you the background here. I mix basically a whole truckload of sawdust on the concrete pad out there, along with a bushel of rye grain that I've soaked overnight. And I mix it real thoroughly. I wet it down to its carrying capacity of water, as much water as will soak into that rye grain and sawdust. And then I put them in these bags. I just take a gallon scoop and scoop a gallon's worth of that mix into each of these bags, fold over the top, load them onto these carts here, the wood-ended ones down there, which fit the inside diameter of this, which is an autoclave or a big retort or pressure cooker. Yeah, it is big. It's a 20-foot or 42-inch diameter. But we fill that thing when we do a full-size batch with four-foot carts spread out down the length of it. And anyway, this is just like a household pressure cooker. I mean, this gigantic boiler here just produces 15 PSI steam, just like you would on a stovetop pressure cooker. Have you ever used a pressure cooker?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it's very similar to that. Very, very similar. Just gigantic.
Yeah.
So we load it in from the outside, and then after it's cooked for 4 hours at 15 PSI, which is, I don't know, 255 Fahrenheit or so, then we let it cool down overnight, and then we open the inside door with it all nice and sterile in here, unload them one cart at a time, 15 blocks lined up in front of the filters there. The filters are what's called a laminar flow bench, which when I turn on the blowers, will produce a nice steady flow of basically perfectly sterile air. They're 99.97% efficient at 0.3 microns, so they won't allow anything as big as a bacterial spore to go through them. Super special filters, really thick, like a foot thick. But basically that provides you with sterile air, so you can open up each bag, put a little starter culture in it, mix it real good, and then, there's actually two steps. After you mix it real thoroughly, you use this, which is my block press. It comes down on it, and you just push down really hard on it, and it pushes the sawdust together very tightly. And then you use that sterile air, grab a big bubble of air on top, and then this actually seals it by melting a strip across the top. So if you look at the bag, each bag has its little bubble, which is a sterile atmosphere and then a melted strip, sealing it from the outside world. Beyond that, for the next 3 months, the only air it can get has to come through this patch. And the patch is basically made from the same material that the filters are made from. It's called a microporous filter patch. And the pore size is so small that no spores can go through it. Nothing living can go through it, but it'll allow gases to exchange. So carbon dioxide can leave and oxygen can go in to keep it alive and healthy. So, you know, but once it's fully colonized, you don't need that anymore because it'll fight for its own space. It won't let other stuff contaminate it.